Hello, and welcome back to the Learn Medicine Show. In this episode, we are reviewing the heart's electroconductive system. And this is a really important topic if you want to get to grips with the underlying physiology of electrocardiograms. So let's get straight down to business. Here is a diagram of the heart. There are four chambers of the heart. The upper chambers are the right atrium, the left atrium, and the lower chambers are the right ventricle and the left ventricle. The outflow tracts are the aorta and the pulmonary artery. But in this tutorial, we will remove the outflow tract to get a better view at the electroconduction pathways. Here are the conduction pathways, and this is the anatomy that you need to know. The sinoatrial node is located in the right atrium. The atrioventricular node, otherwise known as the AV node, is located in the interatrial septum. The AV node is connected to the bundle of His, and this divides into the left and right bundle branch. The left and right bundle branches run the full length of the interventricular septum, and as they enter into the ventricles, the branches divide into Purkinje fibers, and these fibers allow conducted electrical signals to penetrate different areas of the ventricular muscle. In addition to the gross anatomy of the conduction system, there are important cells within the heart that contribute to electroconduction. Sinoatrial node cells are the pacemaker cells of the heart. We'll talk more about these shortly. Atrial myocytes are striated cells that contain actin and myosin. They conduct electrical impulses and contract the atria. Purkinje cells are located in the bundle of His and the left and right bundle branches. These cells are highly specialized myocytes which do not contain contractile units. Instead, these cells are packed with mitochondria and specialist connections called gap junctions. They rapidly conduct electrical impulses at blistering speeds to the ventricles. Finally, ventricular myocytes are striated contractile cells which conduct electrical impulses and contract to bring about coordinated ventricular contraction. Now that we have learnt the anatomy, let's turn our attention to the physiology of electroconduction, which will explain how electrical impulses are generated and travel through the heart. Electrical impulses, known as action potentials, are generated in the sinoatrial node. The action potential is propagated throughout the right and left atrium, and this triggers atrial muscle contraction. The electrical activity reaches the AV node quickly, but the conduction through the AV node is delayed for 120 milliseconds. The atrioventricular node is known as the gateway to the ventricles, controlling the number of impulses which are allowed through from the atria to the ventricular muscle. This pause does two things. It allows the ventricles time to fully fill with blood, but it also has the effect of stopping the heart rate from becoming excessively fast. After this brief pause, the electrical activity spreads to the bundle of His and then down the left and right bundle branches into the ventricles. The electrical excitation causes coordinated muscular contraction of the ventricles. Gradually, the electrical impulse fades away, starting at the outer surface of the ventricle muscle, the epicardium, and fading towards the internal surface, the endocardium. Now that we have learnt how the electrical activity moves through the heart, let's pay closer attention to how these impulses are generated and how they move from cell to cell. To look at this, we're going to start by focusing on the sinoatrial node. The sinoatrial node is known as the dominant pacemaker of the conduction system. It generates impulses at a rate of 60 to 100 beats per minute. The sinoatrial node has specialized cells that have evolved to generate impulses by controlling the net distribution of charged ions across their membrane. To illustrate this, here is an image of the sinoatrial node cell membrane. Note the voltage-gated channels. These will open and close depending on how positive or negative the cell is charged. Calcium, potassium, and sodium ions can also be seen in the extracellular and intracellular spaces. The impulses are generated as follows. sodium ions move into the cell, making the membrane more positive until it reaches the cell's threshold potential of minus 40 millivolts. At this point, calcium channels open and there is a rapid influx of calcium ions. The rise in intracellular calcium generates a positive electrical charge in the cell's membrane of 10 millivolts. The term depolarization is used to describe how the cell goes from a negative to a positive charge. At this point, the potassium channels open and potassium leaves the cell. This brings the membrane's charge back to a negative resting position. This process is known as repolarization. This property of cardiac cells that allows them to generate action potentials is known as automaticity, and it is not unique to sinoatrial node cells. There are other pacemaker cells within the heart, around the AV node and within the ventricles, which mean that if the SA node were ever damaged, there are other pacemaker cells that can take on the role of generating impulses so the heart can go on beating. Impulse production via the SA node is governed by the autonomic nervous system, and this has two branches, the sympathetic, which encourages the body to fight or flight, and the parasympathetic, which encourages rest and relaxation. The sympathetic branch of the autonomic nervous system increases the number of impulses produced in the sinoatrial node. This has the effect of increasing the heart rate. The parasympathetic nervous system reduces the rate of impulses produced and subsequently reduces the heart rate. So we have learned about how the pacemaker action potential is generated. The next challenge faced by the conduction system is how to propagate this action potential to the other cardiac cells, such as the atrial myocytes and the 400 million myocardial cells that make up the ventricles. This is achieved through an adaptation known as gap junctions. Gap junctions, as their name suggests, sit at the junction between two cell membranes and allow a passage from one cell to another. In this image, you can see the sinoatrial node cell on the left. And as it depolarizes, it allows positively charged ions to move into the cardiac myocyte on the right, as well as chemical messengers such as IP3 and cyclic AMP. The net movement of these positively charged ions and molecules generates an internal cascade of events which leads to an action potential and depolarization of the myocyte. So the action potential is propagated from the sinoatrial node through gap junctions into the surrounding tissues, and this cascades down from the atria all the way down to the ventricles. This animation illustrates how the action potential changes from the sinoatrial node as it is conducted through the cardiac conduction system. Although these action potentials have varying shapes, there are particular qualities that they will all share. For example, they will all have a resting membrane potential and an overshoot when the action potential fires. After the overshoot, there will be an absolute refractory period. And during this time, the myocyte is unable to produce any further action potentials, no matter how strong the stimulus. With this particular action potential, this is because sodium channels have become inactivated and cannot open until the membrane potential has repolarized. The absolute refractory period is very important. It prevents cells from firing action potentials rapidly and subsequently prevents the heart from beating too quickly. Following this is the relative refractory period. During this time, the myocyte can generate action potentials, but only if the stimulus is strong enough. It is not essential to know all of these action potentials in detail, but it is worth paying attention to the action potential from the sinoatrial node and from the ventricular myocyte. This image demonstrates when sodium, calcium, and potassium ions either enter or leave the cells. Note that there are differences between the pacemaker potential and the myocyte action potential. This is clinically relevant because certain cardiac drugs will act on ion channels to decrease the heart rate or prolong portions of the action potentials. The final thing I'd like to talk about here is the repolarization of the ventricles and why this starts at the epicardium and moves towards the endocardium. Well, this is nicely explained in the epicardial and endocardial cell action potentials. You'll note that the epicardial action potential is much shorter compared to the endocardial action potential. And for this reason, the epicardial cells repolarize earlier compared to the endocardial cells. And this explains why the myocardium repolarizes from epicardium to endocardium. This brings us to the end of this episode of the Learn Medicine Show. But we'll be back with an even more fascinating and exciting look at how we measure electroconduction in the heart using an electrocardiogram. Thanks for stopping by, and I'll see you again soon.